Today's Midweek Muse video is devoted to our newest group of Joggles cling-mounted stamps. Included this time are some familiar themes. I have wonky houses, background noise, leaves, and scribble flowers, as well as a number of new styles. There are some definitions, some quotes, something I call message in a bubble, and these wonderful engraved images that you see here in the center. And we're going to actually start with those, so let me kind of clear this other stuff out of the way. Now, when you work with these engraved images, when you see the stamps up close once they're inked, what you'll notice right away is that they're made up of little dots. Now, the best way to get a really good impression with them is to use something like a dye-based ink, and you're going to see me bring in Stazon. Technically, it's a solvent-based, but it's not thick like a pigment ink, so it behaves in much the same way as that. You're also going to see me, you can use Distress ink for this, and I want to talk a little bit about re-inking because that's important. Now, when you're working with these really detailed images, the paper that you stamp on is also really important. You definitely want something smooth. You're going to get the best results that way. But having said that, I don't know about you, but I like to stamp on watercolor paper because it allows me to color the images in a kind of painterly-like fashion using markers and various thinned materials to get a watercolor look. So that's important to me. If you're okay with the image not being absolutely perfect, then you can certainly use watercolor paper. Now, what I have here, this is some cream-colored cardstock that's quite smooth, and this is 90-pound watercolor paper. Now, I don't think you're going to be able to see it, but I can definitely feel it. Even though this is cold-pressed watercolor paper, one side is definitely smoother than the other. You're going to want to stamp on that smoother side because it is going to help you get a better image. So let's start with, this is Abigail. She is my favorite, and I've set her up so she's got this cool hat and these funky goggles. Now, when you stamp, and I'm going to use Stazon for her, when you stamp with a stamp this big, first of all, let me back up. You need to really mount these stamps to get a good impression. The only exception to that is going to be the background noise stamps, because I want to use them like this when I'm going to stamp areas, for example, the background on a journal page, and I want to actually flex the stamp and only get parts of the image. Now, this stamp has had the paper removed, but because of the way the cling is sent to us, it has this ivory color paper on the back, and you obviously need to remove that, which exposes the cling. We want to keep that on while we're working on the stamps and shipping them to you, because it's going to protect this from getting dirty. So, having said that, let's come back to Abigail here. What I want to do, a stamp this big, this is the Dilutions journaling block. You have to use something like this. Do not try to stamp these without mounting them. You're going to get far better results. So this is the only thing I'm aware of that's actually big enough to accommodate this stamp, which is pretty tall. It's going to be about 6.5 inches tall by about 4 inches wide. So this is a good size stamp. Again, I'm going to use Stazon. Now, I have re-inked this, so I know that I'm okay, but if you have a dried-out ink pad, do not make yourself crazy. Go ahead and re-ink it first. So, again, I've got some 90-pound watercolor paper here, and I'm feeling I want to get the correct side. I want the smoother of the two sides. Now, what you need to do, I'm going to put another piece underneath just as a little bit of cushion. It helps get a nice impression, and it does take a moment to ink this stamp. It's a big stamp. Now, you want to ink this as I'm doing. Don't turn this over and try to do this on the ink pad. It's just too hard. Go ahead and take your ink pad and apply it to the stamp like this. All right, so that looks reasonably good. I'm going to turn this way. Go ahead and take this journaling block and press it down. And then I just want to come apply nice, even pressure across the stamp so that I get a good impression. Now the end lifted a little bit. Hopefully that didn't get in the way of a nice, good impression, or I didn't get any kind of a double image. And there she is. And how pretty is she? She's got this kind of funky look because she's wearing this hat and she's wearing these goggles. So this is Abigail. We have another one here, and this one I'm going to stamp on the ivory watercolor, excuse me, on the ivory cardstock, the smooth cardstock. This one is called Hidden Beauty. Now, this one is even more finely detailed than Abigail, so she's probably best done on something nice and smooth like cardstock. Again, I'm going to ink her up. Go ahead and turn her over, and I think I'm going to slip something underneath because, again, a little bit of cushion goes a long way toward helping. All right, so this cardstock is not perfectly clean, but for our purposes. And speaking of perfectly clean, one of the things that's important, especially with these highly detailed engraved style images, part of my process, let me grab one of these. Part of my process is when we produce these, they come on a plate. And once we get the plate ready to go, we mount it on this cushion. And then this is all cut as one unit. Now, you can't help it. There's a little bit of dust that happens when you cut all of this stuff. Some of it is the paper. Some of it is the cushion itself. And you're going to find occasionally some of that material on here. You need to keep that in mind. And especially on these, you want to go ahead and make certain that that's all cleaned off. So this is Hidden Beauty. I'm going to bring in some distress ink now, and I want to show you about re-inking. Typically, I would squeeze this, and one eyedropper full would be enough unless this pad were really, really dried out or hadn't been used in a while or had been left open. Then I like to take an old credit card and just go ahead and push the color into the pad, clean that off. And now what I'm going to do, this is called, what is this one called? Too many new stamps, and I can't remember everything. This one is called The Gaze, and this is a set of eyes. So what I'm going to do is just go ahead, and I want to show you that you can use Distress, which is a dye-based ink. Again, a pigment ink is too thick, and it's going to gum this up, and you're not going to get really good results. All right, let's see if I can find something to put underneath here. Grab a small stack. Again, on the watercolor paper, this is the smoothest side, so I'm going to go ahead and stamp these eyes on there. And you can see how cool these are. Now, if you're clever and you look, you'll see that this is actually Abigail's eyes. She, behind these goggles I put on here, her, are these eyes. So as a separate process, I removed the eyes from the whole image and we created this because often you want to have some eyes like that. It just makes a really cool statement. And then the last one in this group, if I could put my hands on it, and it's here someplace, what did I do with it, is one that's called Eye Test, which is a really fun image. Again, I'm going to peel that protective paper off of the cling mount. Then I'll go ahead, and it's important that you have lots of different sizes of acrylic blocks so that you can properly mount your stamps on there. So again, I'll just come in here with, this is Distress Mode Lawn. I'll just come in here and ink this up. Make certain that I've got it well inked, and then I'll stamp this so you can see what this looks like. I'm going to do this on the diagonal because it's a fairly wide image. All right, and there is Eye Test. Now this is just the beginning. I'm going to show you a whole bunch of really interesting things coming up next. Up next are words and text, and you can see that there are several different groups going on here. I'm going to start with this one in the center. It's the only one that I have like this right now. It's nonsense Latin text, and that's exactly what it is. It's just Latin words that actually don't mean anything. I call this one tiny because the type is so small. Eventually, I will produce one that's a little bit larger, but for now, we have this one. There are a couple of quotes here. If you've looked at our stencils, you know that creativity takes courage, which is a quote from Henri Matisse, is one of my favorites. So here that is. I have another one that I'm going to stamp. We have some great definitions here. And these are what I call message in a bubble. And I'll get to those in a second. So let's move all this out of the way. And let me start with the nonsense Latin text. If you're doing something that needs text, this is a perfect example. So I'm going to bring in Black Stays On again. I'll go ahead and ink this. And you'll see that the words are perfectly legible, but the meaning is totally unclear. I mean, there just is no meaning to this. So if I bring this in here, and I go ahead and I press on this so I get a good image, you can see that you get nonsense Latin text. So that's that. Let me bring in, this is another quote. So here's the first quote by Matisse. Let's get the Latin text out of the way. Bring this over here. Again, I can't emphasize enough, you need to have a variety of blocks that will handle all different sizes and shapes of cling-mounted rubber stamps. So this is a quote from Claude Monet. He says, "Color is my day-long," I can't read it upside down, sorry, "color is my day-long obsession, joy, and torment," and I couldn't agree more. Color is my thing. I love to play with color. But boy, can it make you crazy some of the time. So that's the second of the two quotes. Let's bring the definitions out now. I like certain words like believe, cherish, create. and I have Inspire here, and I've given you the word and the definition. Again, very straightforward. I'm just going to ink this with Stazon. I've used a variety of different type styles for these just to give you an interesting look. So here's Inspire, and you can see, again, these are really nice elements for journaling, for cards, for all different kinds of fun things. Last up, these, again, I said, are called Message in a Bubble, and there's going to be a whole group of these. We're going to start off with three. We have Cherish, Believe, and this is Inspire, and what I want to do is produce these words. Again, they make nice little things that you can cut out and put in a project, whether it's an art journal or some sort of a mixed media production, but what you have is this ability to put these words in there, simple messages in a bubble, and as artists, we all can agree that we like these kind of words. So this is all the text-based stuff in this release, and I think you'll agree that it's all pretty cool. Houses continue to be an ongoing theme for me, and in this release, I have three new Wonky Houses rubber stamps. I have number 5, number 6, and number 7, and this time I've got a couple of trees that I've brought in too. These are some of my hand-drawn trees, and they both feature hearts. Now I have a large version here, which once again requires the journaling block because the tree is so wide, and then I have the smaller one. So you can see what I've done here. I've stamped the larger one, and I've gone ahead and put a couple of the houses in as well. So again, this is number 5, this is number 7, let me show you Wonky House number 6. Working with these stamps is really easy. They ink up well, and then they just go ahead and they stamp a nice clean image. So if you wanted to make a street scene, you could certainly do that by lining these up and putting some trees along here. So there's Wonky House number 5, 6, and 7. This is the large heart tree. Let me show you the smaller version. Let me grab a block here and a fresh piece of paper. So this is identical to the larger tree that you see stamped here. The difference is that I've reduced it quite a bit so that if you need to use it on or you need it for a smaller scale project, it's available that way as well. So again, we'll just go ahead and stamp this on here. And there you can see the smaller version of the heart tree. Again, I love houses. I think that they're something thematically that I will continue to pursue. So now putting these aside, what I'll do is I will bring in scribble flowers because they're another recurring theme. Let me just get these out of the way over here. Now this is just a couple of strips of leftover 90-pound watercolor paper, and I came in with the Tim Holtz distress paint and did this. And if you've seen, I've showed this a couple of times. I don't think I need to show you that again. But what's important now is that I've got some larger flowers that you can go ahead and create. So again, this is scribble flower number 5, this is scribble flower number 4. Both of these are considerably larger than the original group of scribble flowers, but you see how fabulous this is. You go ahead and you get your color laid down, and because you have these circles, once you cut this out, you'll see how the color flows from petal to petal. It's a really interesting pattern. Again, this is going to be number 4 right here. Let's pick one of these that's a pretty good size. You can see how this works. And then from here, it's just a process of doing something with a pit. I like to use, not pit, sorry, with a water-based Sharpie marker. This is the extra fine tip. I like to use it to fill in some of the dots. Sometimes I do them all white. Sometimes I'll come back and mix in some Jelly Roll pens. I mean, there's lots of different ways that you can do this. So for example, we'll come over here and we'll do the small ones white. Well, that one's kind of in between. And then it's just a question of grabbing some Jelly Roll pens. So this is here, and you can see how effective this is and how easy it is because all the work is done, all the flowers are drawn. It's just a question of putting the color down, stamping them, and then the fun part, of course, is any embellishments that you choose to add. Now, typically, I only do the center circles, but you could certainly add color. If you wanted to come in and put some design in the petals, you could do that as well. And then from here, it's just a matter of quickly cutting these out. Let me grab some scissors. I use these a lot. They appear in various places, and in fact, I will tell you, I'm working on some new artist trading blocks, and one of them is going to feature, I didn't have these when I was working on it, but it will feature some of the original scribble flowers, and it looks really, really cool. That's coming eventually. I don't quite know when, but it's something that I've been working on. But you can see as I cut this out, the real impact of these is once you cut the petals out, is you can see the color as it flows around in circles, and that makes this really cool. All right, so we're going to finish up with a couple of my critters, some leaves, the background noise, and this one paisley. I think of this as something you complete, meaning you complete it. I've given you the bare bones of the paisley shape, but I've left all this inner area as well as the outside for you to do whatever you want to it. So you could come in and you could add some big circles if you wanted. And then maybe fill in some of the open area with some smaller ones. There's lots of different ways that you can embellish this, but the nice thing is because you have the stamp, you can pretty much do anything you want to it. You could do some stuff on the outside like this, give it some kind of spiky things going on that get bigger as you get to the larger part like this. Lots of different ways that you can embellish it. So you can complete this particular paisley, which is just paisley number one, however you choose. The leaves, again, I'm fond of this shape, and it's one that all of you seem to be as well. All I did was take polished jade and lettuce. I have them in water brushes, and all I did was come in, that's actually a different color, but this is it. All I did was come in and literally paint them like that, and you can see that there was a little bit of blue in here. That's because I blended this with the brushes to get the colors to blend a little bit. So this color here is neither the blue, neither the polished jade or the lettuce. It's a combination of the two. But again, you stroke a little bit of color in it, you have something that looks really cool. So that's those. This is Alfie and this is Ty. Now what I'm gonna do is show you these guys from my journal. This is the original rendition of Alfie, and he was painted the same way that I just showed you, with colors in the water brushes. And then this is Ty. He was done with I think Derwent colored pencils. Honestly, I don't remember. It's been a couple of years. So I want to show you, again, how simple it is. If I bring in my original coloration of Alfie, I'm going to turn this toward me, but I want to show you how easy it is to go ahead. And this looks very watercolor-like, and it's very easy to do. Again, with the Tim Detail water brushes, this is Stream. This is Purple Twilight. All you're going to do is just lay a little bit of color in here very loosely. You don't want to do anything super duper fancy. It's really not necessary. The looser you are, the better this is going to look. I used a little bit of the Purple Twilight. Now I am going to bring in my heated craft tool. I want to dry this just a little bit so I don't get a lot of wicking and running, but I do want to get a little bit of blending. You can see that I added a little bit of color under here. And if it's not blending the way that I want, someplace here, I have a water brush that has just water in it. If I could put my hands on it, here's one. This has just water in it. I can come in and I can loosen this up a little bit. Would have been better if it hadn't had a chance to dry first, but I can come in and I can get this to blend a little bit. I can put a little bit here on his nose, and again, if I think this needs a little bit of water, I can do that just to get this so that it flows a little bit. You can see that I kind of did this in his little top knot, and then I'm going to put some water here. I just want to get that wet. I did the tiniest little bit of shading around his ear. This is not difficult at all. Now, I'm rushing, and I'm not doing a fantastic job, but you can see that it's not terribly difficult. If you want to drag a little bit of this color up into his top knot, you can do that. We can wet this a little bit here, bring in a little bit of the Purple Twilight, and just drag the color down a little bit. Again, you just play, and it's, if you don't like it the first time, try it again. It really is that simple. Now, of course, Ty is a different story because I did him with watercolor, excuse me, with colored pencils. I'm not even going to try to show you that today, but I guess the point is that you have the stamps. It's up to you to decide how you want to go ahead and embellish them. The last thing I want to show you are the background noise stamps. I have, well, let's get this out of the way. I have two new ones today. This one is called Paisley and Circles. I'm just going to bring in some distress ink in peacock feathers. I'm going to ink this, And all I'm going to do is bend this stamp and just roll the image on here and there. Very straightforward. I like the background noise stamps. It allows me to add a little bit of texture to the background of whatever it is that I'm working on with very little effort. So this is the Paisley and Circles. And then if I come over here, I have another page here someplace. I'm going in the wrong direction because I know it's here. Here it is. This one is called Spark. So I'm going to go ahead and ink this. This is Picked Raspberry. Same kind of thing. I'm just going to kind of come in and bend and just lay those sparks down here and there. And that's it. So there are 29 new stamps. I'm really excited about all of them, and I hope that you find some in this group that you decide you'd like to try too.